Ramon Johnson here, 90.5 FM, KSGS, and we are in the lobby of the Fairmont Hotel in downtown San Jose, and I am joined by not only two illustrious African-American men, but they're going to be honored. They're being feted today at San Jose State University, and it's John Carlos and Tommy Smith of the Fist of Freedom, 1968 Olympic fame. Good morning, Tommy.
Morning, son. How you doing today?
Very good. John?
Good morning. I'm really honored to be here.
Well, you know, speaking of honors, receiving an honorary degree, and as we just found out, not a whole lot of folks in the 150-year history of San Jose State have been honored with honorary degrees. John, how does it feel to be one of the few?
Well, first of all, I'm very humbled just by the mere thought that the university would give John Carlos honorary doctorate degree. You know, I think this would be like a paramount move in the history of the Carlos family. I'm overwhelmed by the whole thing. I'm extremely excited. I'm trying to keep my composure, and I'm sure that it's going to take me at least 6 months to a year to just sit down and digest what has just happened in my life.
Now, so in this history, now before you, there was only 17 individuals that had been honored. Now, 18th and 19th, Mr. Carlos, Mr. Smith, Tommy, what do you believe, how do you feel about receiving this honorary doctorate?
Well, again, it is an honor, I suppose, why the honorary degree. It took 37 years, and I think this is about the longest class of anyone to receive a doctorate degree, 37 years, so that's, you know, but it is an honor, and San Jose State has stepped up to do what should have been done by many before this date. And I give San Jose State an accolade also on this day.
Well, as they say, better late than never, but you do bring up a good point. 1968, San Jose State was known as Speed City. It was really the track capital of the world, and you individuals really carried the banner of San Jose out into the world, and then after the protest, you became the forgotten children of San Jose.
Yeah, yeah. You view colleges then and even now with PhDs in certain areas. John Carlos and Tommy Smith had PhDs in speed back then because, biologically speaking, we took our bodies and they ran faster than any other bodies on the face of this earth. And number one and number two in the world in the same event was from the same school and the same team. So I view this as one of the great feats of all time. And academically, we're no dummies. We went to our classes. We did the work we had to do. Otherwise, we could not have run. NC2A is very tough then, and it's even tougher now as far as competition in that division.
You know, you, again, to bring up another good fact is your athletic prowess. And one of the things I think that people tend to forget, getting wrapped up all in the protests and all of those activities, is just what marvelous athletes you were. And now, you know, both of you in your own right, but I mean, so I know there's some competition because, you know, Tommy set a standard, John would go back after it. But let's talk about, starting with John, some of your achievements in college. Of course, prior to, now you'd come, John, from Harlem. You attended school in Texas, and then...
Well, I attended East Texas State University, and I was always intrigued by the fantastic times of the young individual athletes of San Jose State at that particular time. And I just thought it'd be nice to come down to San Jose and visit just to see whether these guys were legit. I came in, and when I came in, I didn't know the true history of San Jose in terms of the greatness, not only by the present athletes such as Tommy Smith and Lee Evans and Ron Davis and those type of individuals, Ben Tucker, Dad, Tim Knowles, but the fact that I came in and felt at home, and the mere fact that I was the baby on the team. I was a young kid that came out. I was honored by the fact that I was there with these great athletes. And then I took the initiative just based on my character and how I see things. There's a new cowboy in town, and you guys are going to have to make over and make room for John Carlos. And they said, well, we don't mind making room. You're just going to have to prove yourself because we don't know whether you're legit or not. And everything worked out. And I think we had a fantastic family and history from that point to the day.
right now, Don. Tommy, you were already here when John came. So now when this brash young man from Harlem came into San Jose, just be honest now, what was the reaction?
I was kind of a quiet kid even then, Ramon, and they told me that this guy was in town, and I said, what guy? They said, this guy, Carlos. And I looked at him from the back. I said, guy walk like he can't be too fast. but he proved to be as good as he looked bad walking. So here we are. And at that particular time, it was the with Smith, Carlos, Evans, Runnery Smith, Sam Davis, Kirk Clayton, all of the 9-3 or better in the 100-yard dash at that time. It was something because we trained together, and my goodness gracious, our training was a Division I track meet.
Well, I might add to that as well. You know, if you take San Jose State, the track team of our era, let's say give or take 10 years going out of the way from the time that we were there together, we could have beat the majority of countries in this planet Earth that we live, just out of the little city called San Jose. I mean, you sit back and you think about what we did. Think about the fact that we met Dionne Warwick and put our personalities and our charismatic personalities with her in Europe, to the point where she came back and wrote a song, Do You Know the Way to San Jose. We thought that was great, although we was a little disappointed that she never mentioned us as being a part of the song. But however, we were glad that she did the song because it enhanced the recognition of San Jose along with what we did on the track.
Well, you know, a lot of people forget about the fine track history at San Jose State University and Bud Winters and what he put together. Of course, I think about it every day because I live about a half a block away from Bud Winters Field, and which is unfortunate that the city of San Jose hasn't done more to recognize. I mean, the university wanted to turn it into a parking lot and everything. For people who don't know, it's at 10th and Alma Street, right across from Spartan Stadium. And if you haven't been, you should go by just to walk. Cause sometimes I walk on that track just to feel like, wait a minute, was that little John over here? Was that little Tommy? Was that Lee Evans over there?
And that's exactly what we felt yesterday. We had an opportunity to go out to the track yesterday. We were saddened, believe me. Tommy was very saddened about it, and I was extremely sad as well to go out there and see the track and the condition that it was in, and just merely to see the fact that it looked like it just was a dead history, so to speak. Many of the people that was out there didn't know our history. They were walking on the track. Then we had an individual that came out that I recognized that used to come out every day when we were out there running in our various track meets, and he was saddened as well. We would hope that one day, just based on the history, the fact that they're bringing Tommy Smith and John Collins back into the fold here at San Jose State, there has to be a birthplace. And you can't have Tommy Smith and John Collins here at San Jose State with no birthplace. And our birthplace is the track. And they must establish the track program back at San Jose State because it gravitates so many individuals to a great sport, and not only to that, to a great institution of education. Track and field provokes education, prosperity, growth, and that's just something that San Jose State is missing right now. So we got to get our baby child back up and running again.
Tommy, how did you feel again walking on that track?
It was saddening. Of course, Ramon, I spent most of my time on the track now where the big complex of the weightlifting complex is over right across the way from it. But I did run a few 20 points in 21.5 and 21.7s in practice in the repeat 200s there. It would be saddening to look down and look at the track and knowing that that's one of the first old Chevron tracks that was laid and still there, and it rocks everywhere. You know, when you lay a pedestal, you kind of want to keep the age of it very divinely. Keep it where people can understand that is a history. This is where a lot of people were born and a lot of people died. Yesterday, out walking on the track, there was a lot of young individuals out there, and we were walking around, and they stopped and asked us, who are you? What are you doing out here? And we said, because this track is where we ran, where we competed. And they looked down at the track and they said, this? And that was the thing that hurt, because it's in such bad shape. We had up in Oakland, there's a Tommy Smith second youth annual track meet at Keysar Stadium last Saturday. And I would love to have brought that Tommy Smith youth track meet to San Jose State track, where I competed. But, you know, you can't do that because San Jose has no track. And by the way, San Jose, you would have to be out of no money because there's a great organization called 100 Black Men of the Bay Area who's putting this track meet on. So I'm really saddened because there's nothing here where I could bring back to the college, because college has no facilities.
Well, you know, with the people and the energy that's put in trying to get a football stadium here, or a baseball stadium, or a soccer stadium, putting some money into that track may be well worthwhile, or at least maybe some plaques, you know, so when people walk around, they can get a sense of the history there. But I do want to let you two know that track does mean a lot to some people, and that's because it's located in the Spartan Keys section of San Jose, which is a rather poor minority section of town, and there are no parks. And so that track now really serves as the only place where people can bring their kids out, walk around, you know.
It has enough land there, and I know people who are in an administrative capacity who might be listening know that it takes money to do these things. But we have human beings out there. That could be a great city park rec location with park and recs in coordination with college to produce a facility like this for community and college. But again, maybe that's too much work for those who don't understand how important athletics now, how important the people are that use that track. And I use people are by making folks understand that it's mostly non-white usage of that track, a minority use of the track. And since socially the area is very much mingled with that move, I think the community should get in contact with reality and do something that's going to procure the love and respect for that area of this valley.
Ramon Johnson here, 90.5 FM KSGS, joined by John Carlos and Tommy Smith. Here, of course, 1968 Olympic, some may say infamy, I say fame, social conscious individuals, both strong sociology backgrounds, and I say that proudly as a sociology major. We'll be enjoying our commencement activities this evening, and the big graduation ceremonies would be tomorrow, which would be May 28th at Spartan Stadium, where both of these gentlemen will be receiving honorary doctorates, and very proudly, and of course, in sociology during the departmental commencement activities this evening. I know you'll be there in spirit, but you'll be being feted by the president, Presidente.
Well, I'd like to extend, and I'm sure everyone out there in Radio Land would like to extend a very, very happy birthday to Tommy Smith. I think he'll be cresting 61 years old, and incidentally, he's been a fine man for the better part of the 40 years I've known him.
John, that's true, okay? But John Carlos will also be 60 one day before I turn 61. So if those who can't, you cannot count, he's 1 year older than I am.
No, one thing, now, and this is great, because one of the things, you know, I'd mentioned to you, gentlemen, was the fact that, you know, I've always been curious how you felt about being paired together. And like I said, you know, there's people who are forever going to be paired in history, like Ollie Frazier, you know, and people like that who are always going to be, you know, Mickey Mantle and Roger Maris and things. But there's people who are paired but don't necessarily like each other, but or who maybe get jealous of never being taken as an individual. Now here, because of your protest at the 1968 Olympics, forever in history, you're going to be paired. Of course, one of the most memorable moments in Olympic history, if not world history, during the 60s, and of course, Olympic history of all time. And so, Tommy, how does it feel to always be stuck with this guy, John Carlos?
Carlos' verbosity overwhelms me sometimes. Because a man can go, you know. I just sit back and say, go on, boy, you're going to do your stuff.
What's the word you just used, brother?
Did you learn that at San Jose State?
Y'all better leave me alone.
Boy, he gets an honorary doctorate, boy. He just brings out the whole Webster Dictionary.
Is your name Don King?
You didn't notice that bulge in my back pocket. That's called Webster, okay? Webster D. Of course it's going to happen, Ramon, when you see two people like this, like Maris, the couple like Muhammad Ali's couple. The greatness of the time usually brings pairs. When one fights by himself, that's not a pair. That's a little bit heretic-ish. That's another word, John, heretic-ish, okay? Yeah, heretic-ish, yeah. So. So I don't mind at all being joined verbally by with a guy like John Carlos. because he's a great man, and I like to be around him because I can sit and listen, you know. But I know John Carlos and Thomas Smith have our own ideas of life. John has his family, I have my family, both wonderful families, and history can pair people. That's great. But the one thing they must remember by people, especially like John Carlos and Tommy Smith, we believe basically in the same thing, God rules, and we honor the necessity to survive faithfully. And the faith is the substance of things hoped for and everything, evidence of things not seen. And Carlos and Smith always had that foresight. But we are different individuals, have different thoughts. Just so happened that one thought in human nature, human rights, brought our thought process together, brought us physically together, but we are not joined at the hip.
All right, John. Now, because since John's a man of few words, we're gonna let him have a few words on Tommy's being joined with Tommy Smith.
Well, what I'm trying to say is, you know, like I've been saying from day one that this thing is divine, the activity that took place. You know, it's a great thing when God take and put people together to do something, and specifically when He put them together to do something as courageous as what Tommy and I did. It stands true to say, hey, it's not one man that did anything. He could have had Tommy go up there and do something by himself, or had John Collins go up there and do something by himself. But he put us up there together to let people know that you can walk down one end of the street and the other person can walk down the other end of the street, but you can come together on one theme and build something great from it. So in terms of me being associated with Tommy Smith, just for the merit of what we did and why we did, it's an honor, and it'll be an honor throughout the Collins family for the duration of time to be a part of the Smith family.
Now, I want to take us back, and we're going to take the Wayback Machine here and go back in time to the 60s and to that era. I want to go back a little bit before the 68 Olympics and to actually give people an idea of what it was like to be an African-American in San Jose in those days. Because now, I've been here, my family came here in 1963, so I was about nine in 68. But, you know, there weren't a whole lot of African-Americans here in San Jose then, so there wasn't enough really for us to be hated. We were more of a curiosity, in a sense. But there was a sense, and there was an underlying prejudice, and there were certain places that African-Americans weren't welcome, and there weren't signs, like maybe in the South, but they let you know. And now, if I remember right, Tommy, now, you live with the Chief Williams family? Did you?
No, I came here from the San Joaquin Valley, you know, down in the Fresno area, picking cotton, chopping cotton, cutting grapes, etc. And my roommate, S.T. Sappho, came from Stockton area, so we became roommates. And Alan Hall, I don't think Alan Hall stands anymore. I have a brick from the corner of it, but it doesn't stand anymore. There were not a lot of blacks on campus. And those blacks that were on campus, and the one or two women on campus, for the exception of the women, all the men were athletes. And there wasn't very many of those. Even back then, scholarships were rough. And the blacks were usually on scholarship because the need to survive, this college to survive athletically. Even one of the most racist coaches from the South said he needed blacks to win. And so we were here on campus to perform physically. And to the amazement of a lot of other people, the non-black instructors, we also made it. And I think Dr. Harry Edwards was one of the first people who did this with straight A's in his major, which is also sociology. So we came to, with a double-barrel shotgun, if you can cope with the phrase, to compete on the field of play and to be real in the classroom. And this surprised a lot of folks, and it still surprised the people. And that rules and regulations on Division III getting so stringent now that it's going back again to the 60s, that if you are a minority, you'd have to be one and a half time as good to just to graduate. I know I'm getting off on an educational thing now, which is, I know you're not here to talk about that, but I do push it very hard. And San Jose State is not the only school that felt that way during those times.
Well, yeah, you can always advocate for education anytime with me because, you know, I'm a believer. But now, you know, going back again into the 60s, being a rather outspoken African-American man may not have been always welcome. And so, John, did you run into any difficulties here in San Jose with your personality?
Well, let me tell you, prior to coming to San Jose State, I attended East Texas State University. East Texas State University at that particular time was like going into the Deep South relative to who you were as a person of color relative to the rest of society there at East Texas State. So I've been bombarded just like, you know, missiles flying through space at my shell, so to speak. So when I came to San Jose State, I saw, you know, prejudice, racism, and bias taking place in San Jose State. But that was not a major effect on me based on the fact that I was aware of that taking place at East Texas State. So my posture was to guide the ship. When I say guide the ship, meaning that I had a wife, I had a young daughter at the time, and I just had to do what was necessary to do to make sure that they were properly taken care of, the fact that I was getting to class on time and that sort of thing. So relative to racism, I've always dealt with racism head on. If I try and get a place to live, I'm going to go head on at them. I'm going to wave my family. I'm going to go head on at them. I'm going to go around the back and get somebody, maybe a white person, to go and get my apartment or go get my house. Once I'm in there, then it was about legality in terms of what they could do legally to get me out. In terms of me be getting upset about racism, I'm not going to get upset as many individuals seem to get upset. My thing is to deal with it at hand. You understand? Racism is a part of the game. It's something that I'm dealing with. And just like they seem to be upset or disturbed about John Carlos as a black man and speaking out against various things, I don't get upset about them, and I would hope that they wouldn't get upset about me. This is just a game in society that we have to play until we come to some understanding as to where we are as human beings on this planet.
It's Ron Johnson here, 90.5 FM KSGS, John Carlos and Tommy Smith here. Real quickly, in the remaining moments that I have, you mentioned Harry Edwards, who, again, is another name that you're linked with, and as we come up on the 68 Olympics, and again, some of the circumstances surrounding the protest, and, you know, when you watch that, and I don't think enough people really put themselves in your position just to realize just how much strength it took on that world stage and at that moment. And again, in those times, that turbulent times of 1968 and all those things that have went on that year, to kind of take us through some of that process and the thought process and again, some of those strong feelings you had inside to be able to make such a stand.
Well, coming from the San Joaquin Valley, then coming from the backwoods of Texas, John Carlos a few moments ago mentioned he attended college at East Texas State. Yeah, East Texas State in Commerce, Texas. I know exactly where that is because 4 and 5 years old, that's where we had to sharecrop. Right there across the railroad tracks, the same railroad tracks that John witnessed trains running some 30 years later. I was there at 4 and 5 years old then doing labor work. So it was a feat to get from Texas to here and then to procure an education, to start a track of the educational process. But, you know, the mind is like a computer. Once seen, we'll remember. You just have to recall. And this is what happened to me coming from Texas to the San Joaquin Valley, to San Jose, and now then through Cambridge and all this stuff. Then back again, it's full circle. And coming to San Jose with a roommate like S.T. Sappho, who was a dean here at the college here at San Jose State, was a blessing in itself because of his background. In Stockton, we had basically same backgrounds with a strong Christian emphasis and doing right. I think we're the only two young black athletes here that put on the same suit every Sunday to go to church down on, I forget what street it is in San Jose. But we did this because of our conviction. And from there, moving through the classrooms, remembering from whence I come, and all the atrocities dealing with political and the social deprivation that I had coming up through Texas, coming through San Joaquin Valley, coming up to San Jose. And I did recall the times that my father was mistreated physically and mentally, socially, financially, because of sharecropping, etc., coming up through those areas. And I saw, witnessed, remembered, then I recall, this was not fair. This was not politically correct according to the Constitution. So I began to do things to find out, why was this done this way? What can be done to make sure it doesn't happen again, at least to my father anyway. So from hence, that's how sociology became a fetish of mine, because I wanted to find out. In social classes, I thought I could. My first major was music. Why music? Because in church, everybody sang. You know, there was 12 kids in my family. We made a whole choir in our church. And I thought, well, that's it. I'll do it in church. I'll be a piano player. That didn't work out. Then I began to realize, I began to think, now I'm fast, and maybe I should do physical education. People think physical education is an easy major. Wrong, sons and daughters. It's one of the most difficult majors we could have because of all the science courses. So I went to where I thought I'd never go. That is into the social part of my surroundings, sociology. So that's where I stuck. I minored in physical education. And those two was very, very right for me and my indignation of what was around me. But I tell you, even though I had learned through silence what the system was about, I had to become educated enough to talk about my feelings about my surroundings. And when I got to San Jose State, I was very confused because what I saw getting there, en route there, my father and what I had to do in San Joaquin Valley just to make it. And St. Sappho, then the Harry, we call him Harry at the time, okay? He was a senior here, this mountain of a man, you know, play basketball. And I used to watch him lumber up and down that court. You know, you think Shaq looked huge. He looked twice the size of Shaq back then, you know. Of course, I went to college and played basketball, actually on a athletic scholarship to play basketball, football, or track. I could choose either. So my first semester here, which was the fall semester, which is basketball semester, I played freshman basketball. I think it was Danny Glines, I think, was here then. Then I decided, well, I don't think I want to because the gym is too small. We had the little gym downstairs, you know, where you played in the dungeon down there and people set up. I crashed into the wall so many times with my layup because I couldn't stop. I couldn't use my speed. So I said, no, this is not me. My future won't be sliding off of anybody's wall. So I left and told Stu Inman at the time, that's Coach Inman, I won't be playing the varsity ball next year. I think I'm going off a track. And he shook my hand and said,
that gym changed the course of history.
yeah. I got tired of eating wood coming off that wall, I tell you.
If you haven't been to Spartan Gym, you have to understand it's like one of those Hoosier type gyms where they have boards all around. The people sit up top. It's almost like being in the Coliseum, and you know, they expect the lions to come out.
Throw a couple of lions down there and they eat them niggas, you know. So that's when I met Bud Winter. But Harry was an instrumental part of my first year because he used to come out Allen Hall. And though you see the guy, the huge mountain of a man he is, he has a side of him that a lot of people don't see. And that's the side of life, the side of funniness and the side of making folks happy. And listening to him, I learn a lot.
And Tommy Smith's talking about Harry Edwards, Dr. Edwards, now, who he's got to be 6'7". 6'8", yeah, he's 6'8", and he weighs about 3,000 pounds. He's a solid man. He's a big man.
He's a very big man, and I know he's around here somewhere, and I'm going to look. I don't have to look too far. Just look above, top of everybody else, you'll probably see him. But that was part of the start of my life at San Jose State, St. Sappho, and Harry at that particular time, and just moving around, finding out how many athletes on camp, how many blacks on campus, and finding out how many of those were athletes. And you know, we shot 100%. Every black we saw on campus, male, was an athlete or connected to the athletic department in some way. And that's how it started here at San Jose State. And so that's where it is now. It's a love affair with me at this college here because that started the second portion of my life.
All right, but with these group of athletes and with the 68 protest, now, so a lot of this rumbling, of course, you had to either be an ostrich with your head in the sand or completely blind not to feel the tension. And, of course, as an African-American, the tensions that were building, you know, there was a certain thing in the air.
The aura of the time. It was just like it was like a plague going all over the United States. And I think a large percentage of that thrust was coming out of San Jose in terms of saying, hey, things has to change. We can no longer continue like this. You know, you have to take into account that most of us, Tommy was married, he had his first kid. Lee Evans was married, he had his first kid. John Carlos was married, had his first kid. So, you know, when you sit back and you think about us, we had to take into account that we were dealing with atrocities, we were dealing with racism, we were dealing with bias, prejudice, but yet and still we took into account that we have to deal with this now so our kids would not have to deal with it tomorrow, at least not to the extent of where we dealt with it or our parents dealt with it before us. So we felt that we had to do something because we felt that many individuals that had opportunity to do something. And when I say opportunity, I'm not talking about Dr. King, the Lone Rider, or Malcolm X, the Lone Rider, Rosa Parks, the Lone Rider. I'm talking about collectively politicians that we had. We had people of color that was politicians. We had people of color that was clergy. We had people of color that was business people. And they never came together collectively to step up and say enough is enough. Young athletes felt like there had to be a change. We felt committed enough that we would do everything possible that we can possibly do to make that change.
You know, and that's a couple of important things you said there, because I don't think enough emphasis has been put on the fact that you were all young fathers. And then coming to that to protect your children, I think that gets overlooked when people try to, you know, delve into the psychology of the movement, but also the attitude of young people at the time, unlike a lot of young people today, that you could make a difference, that, you know, there were possibilities. I think after what happened after Watergate in the 70s, a lot of people got disillusioned, but really in the 60s, there was that sense that, you know what, if we get together, we can make this world a better place.
Well, as I said earlier, I alluded to the fact that, you know, God could have chose Tommy Smith to do it by himself or chose John to do it by himself. He chose to send us up there collectively to show society as a whole that two men could walk different ends of the street but come to one conclusion that a change has to be made and be the sacrificial lamb to make that change. When you sit back and you think about the demonstration and you think about the fist, you know, if you take the fist and you open that hand up, you got five black individuals there. Each of these individuals are walking their separate ways and have their own mind. And they're individuals separately. Imagine that five individuals coming together collectively on one theme and one thought. That becomes very powerful. And I think in essence, the fact that Tommy Smith and John Collison came together in that sense, I think that's what scared the white society. Because here's two young men showing the world that we are solid together on this one issue. And we anticipate being heard. If you don't want to hear us talking to you behind closed doors, maybe we'll be heard publicly upon the Olympic arena. Other people have said, well, why'd you use the Olympic arena? That wasn't the place to do it. But that was the only place to do it. I couldn't do it in Central Square, down on 42nd Street in New York. I couldn't do it in Central Park. I couldn't go to England and do it in Speaker's Corner. I had to be at the Olympic Games to do it. And as you alluded to earlier, Tommy Smith wasn't, you know, just someone went to his door, knocked on his door and told him, said, Mr. Smith, we like you so much, we're going to put you on the Olympic team. He had to go through a process. I had to go through a process to get there. We could have gone up there and put our hands on our hearts and had a lot of tears, but I can't be a hypocrite to myself, and I'm sure Mr. Smith couldn't be one either. If I'd have put my hands on my heart and started crying, it'd be like, well, all those individuals that died on the maiden voyage coming here to America and those that was tarred and feathered and hung and raped and so forth back in those days, it would have been like, well, that was for naught. I don't have any concern about them. Well, I had a tremendous amount of concern about them because I believe in evolution. I believe that when you come here, you recycle when you come back here. I could never think that my father would come back here after me one day and think that, hey, my son was in a position to do something and he chose not to do anything. He was concerned about self.
What do y'all have to say about that?
the genesis of the protest, did it actually take place after you made the Olympic team, or were the seeds being sown prior to, was the talk, the discussion prior to making the Olympic team?
I was here before Carlos, and the meeting started way back in the 67, the late 66, early 67. You see, son, there has been talk about some social movement in 1956, 1960, 1964, and 68. Those people at that time didn't have the backing that we had in 1968. As you heard from John Carlos, you know, it takes a lot of people to mount a front. And we had enough backing. We had people's lives in our hands. We had people's futures. And we used these sadnesses that didn't materialize during those times that so we could do it. And there were two of us. God proclaimed two on the victory stand for the many who had died and for the many to be born to see, to grow from what two people sacrificed for. So these proceedings started in meetings which again surprised the majority of society, because during that time, black athletes were not supposed to be smart enough to meet to talk about something the same, but had different opinions about it, and still came to a conclusive end that, yes, something needs to be done. You do this, I'll do this, and you do that, and together we will make a change, but we'd still have our own ideas of those changes. So there were differences on the Olympic team. There no boycott occurred because there were differences. You had black athletes that were in the military. You had black athletes tied again to something in the system or jobs that they didn't have the strength or the power to go on and do what was necessary because the system had them locked in on something. But it took two, and the two that sacrificed, I think we paid the price for those who could not, or those who would not, and certainly for those who had not.
Ramon Johnson here, 90.5 FM KSS, with Tommy Smith and John Carlos, sharing some of the memories of the 68 Olympics. Of course, they're going to be given honorary doctorates this year by San Jose State University. I'm almost out of time here, but in the remaining time, now, again, you're not going to be able to go through the sociology department commencement activities, but I wanted to, maybe I could play them a little message from you briefly, give them a little message that I could play for them that you can relate since you'll be with the Presidente.
Well, first of all, I'd like to say to Dr. Scott, I'm extremely sorry that I couldn't attend the graduation with you guys this evening. However, I have a heart full of joy and love and admiration for you young students that fought the wars and made the tests and stayed up cramming for those exams and made the class on time. And you well deserve the degrees that you guys are about to get. I'm sorry that I couldn't be with you in the physical, but I am definitely with you mentally and spiritually. Great job, and carry on. Don't forget, always reach back, find a shining star, and throw something to them to help them come the way you're going.
Tommy, you think you can follow that up?
Young folks, you have built the bridge. Now, cross it.
All right. Thanks a lot, John Carlos, Tommy Smith, being honored today, tomorrow, and forever in the hearts of all San Jose State University, and practically should be an entire nation, should give their gratitude to your intestinal fortitude and your heartfelt belief in social issues here in America. Thank you again. Ramon Johnson here, 90.5 FM, KSJS.